what is the trajectory of the post-COVID economic pathway and its impact?
When you say recovery from a recession, we need to be careful. It's not just recovery as in positive growth. There has to be a level of recovery that becomes manifestly useful for this economy. One of Nigeria's growth poles, which is Lagos, suffered immense damage. And so to that extent, I fear that whilst we will doubtless grow in 2021, that growth may not be anywhere near the kind of numbers that would make meaningful impact on unemployment in particular. And I think that for me, there are a couple of things that we need to deal with. We need to deal with unemployment. We need to deal with inflation very, very quickly.
To make the growth meaningful, like Chairman PAC has said, is we have to make sure that people are employed and the negative human development indexes that we have improve significantly for the difference to be felt.
Here we are as a country always crying whenever something happens in the global economy as far as oil is concerned. And so the question we should be asking ourselves is, how is it that accidents that were foretold happen to us all the time? It's a very important question to ask, because then it helps us to take ownership of our problems. Because it is said that until you take ownership of a problem, you can't solve it.
Before this recession and before the COVID, the economy has been growing. 3 years of consistent growth, a slow growth but positive trajectory, was consistently upward growth. But the growth still was not felt. People were still not feeling the impact of what government was doing. Inflation started inching up around August this year. After it had come down to about 11.5%, it started inching up, and now we're at 16%. So there's food inflation. And for us to be able to address the issue of inflation, because when you have food costs, food prices rising, government needs to address it quickly.
Madam Minister, you're right to say that growth had come back. But I wouldn't celebrate the level of growth that had come back after the 2016 recession.
You take incremental benefits as it comes.
It would, you know, because you see, 2016 recession was an incredible opportunity for us to gain consensus toward the most radical sets of reform. You know, when people are in crisis, that's when you can build consensus and say, guys, we've got to do some really tough stuff here.
It's important also to praise the authorities for taking some commendable, timely measures to try to counter the impact of the pandemic in lives and livelihoods. It has most likely saved lives, and it's not an easy situation, no? And with risks still there for a second wave, amid some good news also on vaccine development, I think that this summit and this discussion brings us an opportunity to reflect and think about how the resilience of the Nigerian economy could be strengthened to face such external shocks.
When you go investing in sectors that private money would find interesting and engage in efficiently, like we saw in telecom, you are basically punishing your poor. Your poor need the slim resources that you've got. Your poor, they need the slim resources that we have should go to pro-poor investments. Those pro-poor investments matter, because that's what lifts people to the place where they can engage in economic activities. What I see today is that we're struggling. We're struggling in terms of what my dear brother Doyin called economic clarity.
If you look at Nigeria's history of policy making over the last 30, 40 years, what has typically happened is that a shock from outside, in most other countries, a shock from outside, the government keeps the shock in. In Nigeria, you shift the shock into the private sector. And so, unfortunately, in therefore my view, whenever there's a shock from outside, Nigeria shutters down and waits until slightly better conditions exist. Then we try and say, okay, so where do we go?
We're still very much optimistic that the economy will recover quite quickly from recession and be on its way to part of growth. We projected before NSAS happened that the growth will be at 3%. But we have to do a review now to see whether that will still hold, because that's a very significant event that has happened. But still, we will go back to growth.
You see, the thing about economic management is that you can't wing it. You know, you can't wing economic management. When you are running an economy well, it tells. When an economy is not being run well, it also tells. You can't sort of say, I'm running it well, however, certain things are not happening. Take, for example, three things are important. You need whatever number of things you lay out on the table concerning economic management, you can bring them under three broad categories. You can bring them under sound economic policies or sound policies in general. You can bring them under strong institutions. You can bring them under sensible priorities of public investment that become a magnet for private investment. These three things are struggling. They were struggling in our country in economic management.
The importance of trying to restore macroeconomic stability is essential. And it was well explained what macro stability is, but maybe I'll give another way here to explain. It's restoring confidence. It's making sure that investors feel confident to invest in the economy, domestic and foreign investors. For that, you need predictability. So macro stability offers predictability. It reduces the volatility. You know, you have growth, very high growth in 1 year, very low growth in other years. In the past 5 years, Nigeria has not even had a very, very high growth. Inflation is very volatile. It goes up, it goes down. The exchange rate is volatile despite efforts of keeping stable. So all these are critical parameters for the investment decision that is required for Nigeria to move ahead. So it needs to start, and it needs to start as soon as possible